evening, I want to welcome everyone to Wednesday night Bible study. The First Community Antioch family, I welcome you, and I welcome all the other listeners that have tuned in. Tonight, we will be discussing, and I'll be discussing John 15, chapter of John, verse 5. That's John 15, verse 5. And it's read, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing." Bow our heads in prayer. Father, we thank you for another Wednesday night, Father. We thank you for just keeping us and watching over us. We give you the glory, we give you the honor, we give you the praise, Father. And right now, I pray that every heart and mind is open to your word tonight, Father, that whatever is said, Father, that you would receive the glory. And we ask this in Jesus' name, amen. The title of the talk tonight is going to be "Without Christ, Nothing." Without Christ, nothing. A dear friend of mine, we go fishing all the time, but when we didn't go together, we would always want to get a fishing report from each other. And one of the things that we would do, we'd call and ask the other one, said, "What did you do today?" And he said, "Close your eyes and tell me what you see." And the dude said, "Nothing." He said, "Mean you caught nothing?" He said, "Nothing, not a bite." So with the title, I want you to think about it. Without Christ, nothing. Without Christ, nothing. Now there are four elements to this parable: the vine, the branches, the gardener, or the vine dresser, and the fruit. Now it is quite true that unregenerated men, being without Christ, can do nothing spiritual whatsoever, and can do nothing which is acceptable in the sight of God. But our Lord and Savior was not talking to the unregenerated. He was talking to his disciples. He was surrounded by them at that time. And he told them, as branches of the true vine, that he said, "Without me, you can do nothing." Jesus was speaking to them, to his disciples. And he's speaking to us tonight also. I pray that we would listen very carefully to the message, because God is actually, he's speaking to us through his word all the time, but maybe tonight just something special that you would listen very carefully. The cultivation of a vineyard was very important to the life and economy of Israel. I'm going to give you a little history before I get into the lesson itself. But there are actually three different vines found in the scripture. The first one is the past vine, and this was the nation of Israel. And you can find some related scriptures, Psalms 80, verses 8 through 19, and Isaiah 5, 1 through 4. By the way, if you're in the Bible study and we're doing that, we should have a pen and a paper close to us, especially if we're at home right now, to where we can jot down these scriptures. That's Psalms 80, 8 through 19. Verses 8 to 19, and Isaiah 5, 1 through 7. In an act of wonderful grace, God transplanted Israel into Canaan. And this was the promised land, the land of milk and honey, the fertile land. And in Exodus 17, we'll put that on the board if we can, Exodus 17, and it's read, "So I said, I will bring you out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of Canaanite and to the Hittite, and into the Amorite and to the Perizzite and to the Hivite and to the Jebusite, to a land flowing with milk and honey." Now, that land with milk and honey, it was a land more than likely that described the area where they had goats at the time, and this is what was going on during that time. They had herders of goats. The bees would probably indicate the honey, but and all in all, what it represented is that it was fertile land. God had put his people into a fertile land. And not only had he put them into a fertile land, God had given them everything that was needed to succeed in. Everything that the nation needed. Let's go to Numbers 13 and 27. That's Numbers 13 and 27. Read that. Just bear with me for a minute. Thus they told him and said, we went into the land where you sent us, and it certainly does flow with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. This was a fertile land. This was a very good land, and this is where God had put his people. In Isaiah 5 and 4, it said, what more was there to be done for my vineyard than have not done in it? If every nation had everything it needed to succeed, it was Israel. But what about us now? God has given us, this nation, everything we need to see. But we have turned away from God. There is no fear of God. There's no absolute. And whatsoever we feel like doing, we just do it without any thought of the consequences. It's not about God anymore. It's about us. But God is still God. He will never change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I thank God that he does not change. God is asking us today, or tonight, what more? What more can he give? What more can he do for us? He has given us his very best. He gave us his son, Jesus, who died on the cross for us. God gave us his very, very best. What more do we need? Sometimes we ask God over and over for things over and over, but God has given us everything that we need. Now, the future vine, I talked about the past vine, I'm going to mention the future vine. Just remember there's three different vines that's described in the scripture. It's the vine of the earth, described in Revelation 14 and 20, and you can jot that down and read it when you get a chance. That is the Gentile world system ripening for God's judgment. The believers are the branches in the vine of heaven, but the unsaved are the branches in the vine of the earth. Now, the present vine, we know that the present vine is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, of course. The vine also includes the branches, which is us. He is the true vine, that is the original, of which there all others are just copies. As Christians, we do not live on substitute. The symbolization of the vine and the branches is similar to that of the head and the body. We have a living relationship with Christ and belong to him. God has given us everything we need through Christ. What more can we do? What more can he do? There's a lot we can do. God has done it all for us through Christ. He must learn how to tap into the resources. We have to know what God has given us and how to use it. We must remain. When he said abide in the vine, if we are to succeed, if we are to have the things that God has done for us, then we have to stay in the vine, remain in the vine. Remember the message, without Christ, nothing. Let's talk a little bit about the branches. We talked about the vine, the present vine, which is Christ. Of itself, a branch is weak and useless. It is good for either bearing or burning, but not for building. And if there's only 15 verses in Ezekiel 15 chapter, read it when you get a chance. And there's only 8 verses in that, but I'm going to read a verse It says the outcast vine, this is verse 8, and it's the King James Version, the study Bible. Thus I will make the land desolate because they have persisted in unfaithfulness, says the Lord God. We must stay faithful to God if we are to produce fruit. Ongoing faith and loving obedience to the Father and the Son results in fruit. We have to stay attached to the vine. Communion with Christ and the Holy Spirit is very important. Do not lose hope. Regardless of how things look, we have hope and a living hope in Christ. Now, this is important. This is very important. Do not pull away from your resources. Stay attached. Without Christ, nothing. We're going to talk about the gardener right now. And the gardener is nobody other than God himself. He is in charge of the caring of the vine. Jesus said this in the work of the Father. He purges, he prunes the branches so that they will produce more fruit. Note the progression. No fruit, more fruit, and much fruit. Many Christians pray that God will make them more fruitful, but they do not enjoy the pruning process that follows. Sometimes we confuse activity with progress. There's a difference between being busy and being fruitful. Sometimes we involve ourselves in all types of activities, good activities, but are we just being busy or are we being fruitful? The gardener or the vine dresser prunes the vine in two ways, the branches. He cuts away the dead wood that can breed disease and insects. What could be dead wood, he gets rid of it. We all could fill out the blank. What it is in our lives that could be considered dead wood. It's not doing anything. It's just causing us to have a disease or to infect our body with different things. He cuts away living tissue so that the life of the vine will not be dissipated, that the quality of the crop will not be jeopardized. What can ruin the quality of the crop? I'm glad you asked that. Pride, lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, smoking, drinking, gambling, all of these things can ruin the crop. I'm not talking about the vine, I'm talking about our lives. There must be something or some things removed out of our lives if we are to produce fruit. Sometimes the vine dresser will cut away whole branches of grapes so that the rest of the crop will be a high quality. God wants both quality and quantity from his people. We're not just talking about that. We're talking about us. What more could he do? We have a responsibility also. Now, the pruning process is the most important part of the whole enterprise, and the people who do it must carefully be trained, or they can destroy the entire crop. Sometimes it takes 2 to 3 years in training to know where to cut, how much to cut, and even what angle to cut. I remember Pastor Gaines preaching a message, and he said that God had told him that, Ferdinand, what the problem is that you want the product, but you don't want the process. And I truly believe that that is so true. I understand what he meant. We want the finished product, but we don't want to go through the process. We don't want to be pruned. We don't want God to work in us and do the things that need to be so we can produce not just more fruit, but much fruit, spiritual fruit. I do believe that the greatest judgment that God could bring to a believer would be to let him alone and let him have his own way. We have to realize that it's God. It's all about God, what he wants us to do. He has a purpose for us. Because God loves us, he prunes us and encourages us to bear more fruit for his glory, not our glory, it's for his glory. I thank God that he does not leave us alone. Pruning hurts, But God knows what is best for us. God always, always gives us his very best. Why? Because he loves us. Yes, God loves us. He loved both the saved and the unsaved. He loves all of his creation. He loves one no more than the other. Now, pruning does not simply mean removing what is bad. It can be also mean cutting away the good and the better so that we might enjoy the best. Let me rephrase that. It can also mean cutting away the good and the better so that we may enjoy the best. Thank you. That's what God wants us to do. He wants us to have the very best, but sometimes he has to remove some things out of our life. The more we abide in Christ, the more fruit we bear. And the more fruit we bear, the more the Father has to prune us. Just remember, the process has to occur. So when you're going through something, it's the process of what God is making us better so we can produce more fruit, much fruit, better fruit. Why? So that the quality keeps up with the quantity. Ah, that's pretty good. This is what brings glory to God. Not just giving God anything. He wants the quality, but he wants quantity also. The very best. Now let's talk a little bit about the fruit. The word result is often heard in conversation among Christian workers, but this is actually not a biblical concept. Let me explain to you why it's not. A machine can produce results. A robot can produce results. But it takes a living organism to produce fruit. Let me go back and say this again. A machine can produce results. A robot can produce results. But it takes a living organism to produce fruit. It takes time and cultivation to produce fruit. A good crop does not come overnight. It takes time, people. It takes time to learn God's word, to do what God wants you to do. It takes time, but you have to spend time with him. In life, we have two wonderful gifts, time and the ability to choose how to spend it. Make it a habit from this day on, a daily part of your routine. And what I mean by that is prayer should always be a daily part of it. Reading God's word should be a part of it. Studying God's word should be a part of your day. Meditating on God's word should be a part. And here's the last thing that we should do. Once we do all of that, we should share God's word. This is producing fruit. You remember our theme for this year is fishing for many in 2020? We must remain or remember that the branches do not eat the fruit, others do. We must remember that the branches do not eat the fruit, others eat the fruit. We are not producing fruit to please ourselves, but to serve others. We should be the kind of people who feed others by our word and our action. I say this all the time. My dad had words that he used, and he said, Christians have all the right answers, believe in Christ, follow Christ, and accept Christ. But their words and their lifestyle didn't add up. But this is what his word was. I can't hear what you're saying for seeing what you do. Our words and our actions should line up if we are to produce fruit. It will not happen. We cannot be affected if we do not. Several different kinds of spiritual fruit are named in the Bible. One of them is we bear fruit when we win others to Christ. We bear fruit when we win others to Christ. Fishing for many in 2020. If you have your pencil, jot down Romans 1 and 13. Write it down. God has placed every spiritual gift in the church that the church needs. All the gifts are there. We just have to exercise the gift that God has given. Sometimes we spend more time on our agenda than God's agenda, and that's a problem. That's a real big problem. But getting back to where it said we bear fruit when we win others to Christ, I want to read something to you that I thought was very interesting. It's about 10 little Christians. And I'm going to read it to you. It says, 10 little Christians standing in line. One disliked the preacher, then there was nine. Nine little Christians stayed up very late. One overslept on Sunday, and then there was eight. Eight little Christians on their way to heaven. One took the low road, and then there was seven. Seven little Christians chirping like chicks. One disliked the music, then there was six. Six little Christians seemed very much alive, but one lost his interest, then there was five. Five little Christians pulled from heaven's shore, but one stopped to rest, and then there was four. Four little Christians, each busy as a bee. Three little Christians knew not what to do. One joined the sporty crowd, then there was two. Two little Christians, our rhyme is nearly done, different with each other, and then there was one. But here's what happened. Let me show you. Fishing for many in 2020. This is what can happen. One little Christian can't do much, 'tis true. Brought his friend to Bible study, and then there was two. Two earnest Christians each invited one more. That doubled their number, and then there was four. Four sincere Christians worked early and late. Each prayed for another, and then there was eight. Eight splendid Christians, if they doubled as before in just so many Sundays, we would have 1,024. We have to reach out to those lost souls. Now here is the little jingle to this poem that I gave you. It says, there is a lesson is true. You either belong to the builder or the wrecking crew. We have to build one another up. This is all about Christ. This is about what God wants us. If we, as individuals, would lead one individual to Christ, just one individual to Christ, we have no idea how far it would go. We may reach thousands, maybe 10,000, maybe even a million people because we witnessed to one individual. Think about it. This is what we are supposed to be doing. This is part of the way that we can produce fruit. Another way we can produce fruit, we are part of the harvest. John 4, 35 and 8. You can write that down and read it in your time. But we are part of the harvest. John 4, 35 and 30, 35 to 38. Another way is that as we grow in holiness and obedience, we are bearing fruit. As we grow in holiness and obedience, we are bearing fruit. Romans 6 and 22. I'm giving you a scripture. We're not going to put them all on the board, but I'm giving you the scripture that you can go to and read while you study, and you can confirm everything that I'm telling you. And four, the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5, 22, 23 is the kind of Christian character that glorifies God and makes Christ real to others. I don't know about you, when I read the fruit of the Spirit, joy, peace, love, kindness, patience, long-suffering, self-control. When you read the fruit of the Spirit, I see many of them that I need in my life. We don't have it all. God, we just didn't pick these up. These are gifts of the Spirit, fruit of the Spirit, that should be producing the character of God that will glorify God. And it makes Christ, when people see that in us, it makes Christ real to them. I don't need any Greek terms or some word that you may not ever remember. But I'm going to tell you that if we want to reveal Christ in our lives to others, we can let the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit, we can have those. Without Christ, nothing. Close your eyes. What do you see? Nothing. Without Christ, we have nothing. What would happen? What do you think would happen I believe sometimes our churches have become businesses. We've operated in ways that God did not intend for us to operate in. There was a particular group, organization. They had 10,000 churches that preached two sermons a week. And after they did the math on it was over a million and some sermons that was preached out of the 10 churches, and not one soul was saved. Not one was baptized. What happened? Are we still preaching Jesus on the cross? Are we still reaching out for lost souls? Or have we gotten too busy with other things? We're being busy and not fruitful. I don't know. But for that many sermons to be preached and not one soul to be saved or baptized, something is wrong. What would the church actually look like if it looked like Jesus? Even our good works, our services, grow out of abiding life. Colossians 1 and 10. Write it down and read it when you get a chance in your study. And here's another one, and then I'm going to move a little bit further. The praise that comes from our heart and lips is actually fruit to glorify our God. It's to the glory of God that we praise and worship Him. Hebrews 13 and 15. You know, we sang that song sometimes, say every praise of worship is to our God. Every praise of worship. That's fruit. We're getting better. We're learning more and more about Christ. We're becoming more like Him. A true branch united with the vine will always bear fruit. Always. But not every branch bears a bumper crop. Just as not every field has a bumper harvest. But there is always fruit where there is life. Matthew 13, and read verse 8 and verse 23. Not every branch bears a bumper crop. Not every field bears a bumper crop. Now, without Christ, we cannot produce fruit. Bottom line, we cannot produce the fruit. We can't do it at all. But there is something that I was reading, and it was very interesting when he said to be part of it. Says, without me, you can do nothing. There's one word that stands out into that verse to me that really stands out, and it's do. Do. It gives me hope because I know that I can do something to help change the situation. God has given us the resources, but we can't produce the fruit if we don't change. Romans 12, chapter 12, teaches how to live the Christian life. Verses 1 and 2, but it says, I beseech you, brothers, by the mercy of God, to present yourself your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. But it says, be not conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you can prove what is the true and perfect will of God. God has a purpose and a plan for us. He's given us everything we need. What more could He do? The fruit is there to be produced. But we have to stay connected to the vine. If we fall away, now, this can be a dangerous interpretation of Scripture when you say that, because you're not saying that if you don't win any souls, if in evangelism, if I don't win any souls, I'm going to fall off. No, that's not what it says, because it can be interpreted that way also. But that's not what it's saying. God is saying if we stay connected to the it's three things, and I'm gonna close with that. There's three things that we must have. Faith is one. We gotta believe in what Christ has did on the cross. Remember, I told you, this Jesus was not talking to unregenerated men. He was talking to what? Regenerated. People that were saved, that had accepted Christ. The second thing is that we have to have hope. We have hope. We have not just a hope. We have living hope. And the third thing is that we have to have love. None of this will happen if those three things do not occur. Faith, hope, and love, if we are to produce fruit. Now, if there's anyone that's listening that don't know Jesus as their personal Savior, I'm going to give you three simple ways to do that. They call it the ABCs of Christ. The ABCs. The first thing you'll have to do is admit. Admit that you're lost. Admit that you're a sinner. B is to believe. Believe what Jesus had done on the cross, that he died for your sins and the sins of the world. He was buried, and 3 days later he rose again, that you may have eternal life. You got to believe that. And the third thing is that you have to confess those sins. Bring them to God. Confess them. Ask him to change your life, to take them away from you, forgive you of those sins, and you are saved. That's what you have to do. Romans 10, when you read Romans 10 and 9 and 10, it will tell you very clearly that if you should confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, shall believe in their heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. That's what this is about. Reaching out to others. Building up God's kingdom. Being fruitful. Not busyness, but being fruitful. It's very simple. But sometimes it's very painful. We're going through a time now where everything seems to be out of balance. The weather, everything seems to be thrown out of balance. But one thing that will never change, again, is God. He's going to stay the same. His word is going to stay the same. And we must abide in the true vine, the only true vine. To bow your heads. Father, thank you, Father, for each and every one that was listening. I pray that your word has touched your heart. I pray that you would make your face shine upon them, Father, and that your grace would be poured out on them, Father, that they may have peace. I pray that every chain be broken. I pray that every burden be lifted. I pray that every enemy be destroyed, and I pray that every need is being met, Father. I pray that every prayer, Father, would be answered by you, because, Father, you are the one that's able, and you're the one that's willing. I pray, Father, that we would all look at our lives and see if we're just being busy, or are we being fruitful? Are we fishing for many in 2020? Are we following the guidelines, the rules that you have set before? You said that we are to love you with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second one is likened unto the first, is love thy neighbors as thyself. Faith, hope, and love, Father. Keep it in our hearts, Father. Thank you for enlightening us, Father. Thank you for exciting us. And thank you for encouraging us through your word, Father. And I just thank you right now, Father, in Jesus' name.